Brilliant. So, today's lecture is looking at UN, it's entitled UN Peacekeeping Operations and Their Role in Sustainable Peacebuilding. And the area I'm looking at particularly is the interface really between the deployment of UN peacekeeping operations, which is largely, although a civilian-led type mission, and I'll explain what a peacekeeping mission sort of looks like in a bit, it's you know, quite a heavily military orientated mission. Yet the goal of peacekeeping in many ways is to open up space for conflicts to resolve and open up space for sustainable peace building, which is not a military activity. It's a much more civilian orientated dimension where the key actors, you know, shouldn't really be military personnel. So we're going to kind of explore that a little bit and have a discussion afterwards. A little bit about myself when I find how to move to the next slide. There we go. There we are. As I've kind of already said, I'm an assistant professor here at Coventry University. And I research peacekeeping, peace building, conflict resolution. And predominantly, I've looked at how military personnel are trained to be peacekeepers, which is going to be a bit of what we speak about today. The links between peacekeeping and peace building in UN terminology. Then I look at particular countries. So I've been working on how the United Kingdom approaches the United Nations in terms of peacekeeping. And then sort of policy areas as well with regards to what is classed as protection of civilians in UN operations, how the UN is geared to actually carry out protection. And all of this is kind of underpinned by this idea that I mentioned about conflict resolution. For me, the underlying kind of aspect of UN peacekeeping is that it has the potential to be an actor in conflict resolution. I don't say it is an actor in conflict resolution because I think that's a bit too strong to say, because the UN, there's many examples of when the UN hasn't necessarily resolved conflict in ways that people want them to be resolved. But I would say that the UN has got potential in which to do this. It's an actor that intervenes into violent conflict with the intention of conflict de-escalation, and, you know, ultimately building non-violent forms of conflict, you know, or building space for non-violent forms of conflict, be that, you know, elections, be that political debate. The role of UN peacekeeping is partly to stop that world becoming a violent, you know, space. So yeah, I mean, that's really, you know, what I've been doing since being at Coventry, and I've been active in like many of the lecturers, active in the kind of bringing research out and publications out in this area. So to quickly kind of give a one slide overview of UN peacekeeping, you may have seen pictures of UN missions in the news, generally soldiers with blue helmets dotted around the globe. And that's what a traditional UN peacekeeping operation may look like. The UN has got and currently over 70,000 uniformed personnel deployed in something like 12 to 15 missions. These are the peace. I'm focusing on peace. This is again a bit of a caveat, because I know we have a Colombia specialist here on the call where there's a UN presence and a UN operation. That's in sort of the UN terminology would be classed as a political mission, which is much more civilian led. I'm looking more at the large multifunctional peacekeeping operations, just to create that divide. So generally, how these missions characterize the military police and civilian personnel under the UN flag into situations of violent conflict. Traditionally, the traditional route for a UN operation would be that there would be, a peace agreement signed between parties in a violent conflict. Part of that peace agreement is the incorporation of a United Nations operation, which will oversee a ceasefire, oversee demilitarization, oversee de-escalation. The military have always, the first mission, the first observation mission was 1948 in India, in the border between India and Pakistan, which is still ongoing. The military have always been seen as the kind of the best tool for the United Nations to do these types of missions. They know what, particularly with ceasefire monitoring, for instance, and observation. Missions have very much developed since the first peacekeeping mission in India, Pakistan. Now, what is often seen, since the 90s, the significant trend has been missions that have been deployed within states, where there's been a breakdown of the state and the state's capacities, a civil war, multiple armed and unarmed opposition groups within a country. And often a shakier, much less well-defined peace agreement that parties sign up to. So, for instance, the most contemporary mission, I put a little list there: Mali, Central African Republic, South Sudan, Lebanon, and Cyprus. The last two missions, Lebanon and Cyprus, have been going since, well, Cyprus has been since the mid-1950s, and Lebanon has been since the 1970s, I believe. Mali, Central African Republic, and South Sudan are very new and contemporary missions that are ongoing, and very challenging missions at the same time. When the UN, there is a decision to be made to deploy a mission, the UN Secretary General diplomats or no secretariat officials at that level basically scour the world for military personnel, civilian personnel, or police personnel predominantly, to be deployed into missions. So countries like the UK, like Belgium, like Rwanda, like India will provide soldiers to go on mission to the UN. So the UN doesn't have a standing army capacity. It gets everything from its member states. And so, for instance, the UK has got soldiers in Mali currently. The UK's currently just deployed a battalion to Mali, but the UK has always been deploying in Cyprus. That's been where the UK has sent most of its soldiers on UN duties. The top contributors are generally countries from the global south. So we'll see Bangladesh, Nepal, India, Pakistan, and a number of sub-Saharan African countries that will be big contributors to UN operations. Now, the thing that kind of makes UN peacekeeping missions unique is that they're always, at a political level and at quite an operational level, these missions have three core things that they have to be doing. And the extent to which they do this is there's been many books written on these, but when you hear how people speak about peacekeeping, they'll say that peacekeeping missions, first of all, need to have consent of the parties to the conflict. So all the people in the conflict, the armed groups predominantly, but the local actors, need to consent to the peacekeeping mission being deployed. That's why a peace agreement generally is the barometer for that consent that is part of a peace process. Second of all, peacekeeping operations must be impartial. They take no sides in a conflict. They are third party interveners. And the third kind of principle is non-use of force apart from self-defense and defense of the mandate. So peacekeeping operations, although generally staffed by military personnel, will see the use of force as the last resort. And, far more so than a traditional military operation, let's say. And these three principles kind of bring this activity into the sphere of conflict resolution, because issues of consent promotion and, you know, working to build relationships and positive relationships is there. The non-use of force aspect certainly means that, you know, non-violent forms of conflict de-escalation are important, you know, hardwired into the whole system. And if non-violent forms of conflict de-escalation are important, then it's sometimes quite a that leads to the interesting dynamics that we'll kind of explore here with regards to asking military personnel to engage in that, because military personnel generally are trained not, you know, to consider, you know many of, you know, that kind of non-violence sort of aspect. I group all military personnel there. I know there are differences between military personnel. Just as a quick map to kind of illustrate, this is where current UN missions are deployed. As you'll see, most missions are deployed in the Global South. You don't see many UN peacekeeping missions deployed, in Western Europe or, you know, North America. The largest number of missions are in the African continent. The UN is very active and has been active in the African continent. And as you can see, some missions have lasted India and Pakistan since January 1949. Sorry, I got my dates mixed up there. And then you've got the most recent missions, South Sudan since 2011, Central African Republic 2014, and Mali since 2013. So this map is a little bit dated because it says there's 125,000 UN peacekeeping personnel. That number has decreased significantly, particularly in the last 4 or 5 years when the Trump administration really put a lot of budget cuts on the UN generally and peacekeeping in particular. So how does this interact with conflict resolution and peace studies? I've sort of explored this a bit. So studies of conflict resolution are concerned with approaches of third party intervention into violent conflict. And UN peacekeeping is often seen as third party intervention into the most violent, of conflicts. If you know of your Johann Galtung and ideas of negative peace and positive peace, you can transplant this into UN operations. So you have the idea of stopping violence, negative peace. UN peacekeeping missions traditionally have been very good at that bit, stopping. So mission in Cyprus, really good example. UN mission is ceasefire monitoring, a ceasefire that was signed in 1974. There hasn't been an outbreak of fighting really at the level that since. Now, Cyprus is also a very good example of the UN's inability in that case to pursue positive peace, restoration of relationships. In effect, the UN's ultimate goal is that it should leave in these missions. It should get out because there's enough local capacity for positive peace. In the case of Cyprus, as a good example, there's a ceasefire monitoring mission, but there's not much positive peace, at least at a strategic enough level for the UN to leave. But the aim of UN missions is certainly now, you know, when large deployments in places like the DRC, is that the UN will oversee elections, will oversee disarmament, demobilization, reintegration programs, all to pursue that idea that society is a sustainable peace at the end. Now, for all of this to happen, this is where kind of my little research niche is for this to be achieved, it's incumbent that peacekeeping personnel have requisite training and awareness to understand their role in conflict and to operationalize that knowledge with skills and techniques. So this is, when the UN deploys, it deploys with soldiers that have largely been trained in country. You know, from the UK, soldiers will have been trained for the UN mission. But in many aspects, because of the conflict resolution role of UN peacekeeping missions, I would argue that pretty much everybody involved in a peacekeeping mission is to some degree a version of a conflict resolver or a conflict resolution practitioner. And that might be my own conceptual leap, but the ability of the UN to do its work at a strategic level really relies on many of the people at very local levels to do their work efficiently, effectively. And part of that is understanding that they are conflict resolvers, or they are actors in a conflict resolution process. And if that's the case, what skills, tools, techniques do they need? So with that in mind, we'll look at three challenges. I know it's 20 past 10 already, and I understand I've got to leave space for discussion, but we'll get through these three challenges relatively efficiently. So I've identified three challenges just to sort of bounce around for today. Do we see a policy requirement for peacekeepers to be aware of a changeover between negative and positive peace? What happens if this role of peacekeepers is not understood or poorly executed? And what is the implication on training programs? That's, I suppose, it's three questions as opposed to three challenges. So we'll just quickly look over these three areas, and then we can have a discussion if needs be. So first of all, you know, do we see a policy requirement? The short answer to this is yes. The UN has really, as an institution, has really incorporated this link between negative and positive peace. And this is outlined in a lot of its most recent policy. As I said, I'm looking at peacekeeping and peacebuilding. The UN will now call a good example of the kind of rate of change. The UN had, up until 2 years ago, a Department of Peacekeeping Operations. And they've rechanged the name of that to the Department of Peace Operations. And that's quite an important indicator, because what the idea is in the UN thinking is that peacekeeping missions, this deployment of military police, is only part of a peace process. It's not the be-all and end-all. So missions such as what we see in Colombia, you know, political missions like in Afghanistan as well, which have got much more of a civilian footprint, are in many ways as important. You know, they shouldn't be, and it's part of a continuum. And when the idea of UN peacekeeper missions is to ultimately withdraw, what they leave behind is generally a smaller civilian-led mission. So there's a transition from a large footprint to a medium-sized footprint to a small footprint to the UN disappearing. That's the theory in the UN. So missions in Sierra Leone, Liberia particularly, have transitioned downwards. You know, a mission drawdown, this idea of, I mean, if you speak in military terms, they'll call it an exit strategy. The UN loves and will always want to know how it is actually going to leave a country. And if you look at the slide, which has the timeline of when missions have deployed, you can see that leaving countries is a very hard job for the UN to do. So the UN is always looking for how it can transition out of missions. And the key to that is how sustainable the peace is without the UN having to be there. A kind of level to the, you know, with regards to the actual peacekeepers, the Security Council resolutions have been passed, you know, explaining this. And very good example is 2086, which is called, you know, peacekeepers as early stage peace builders. So the UN has written a Security Council resolution which says peacekeepers, necessary skills and equipment, appropriate language, yes, the appropriate language, skills at relevant levels. The idea is of this particular resolution is that peacekeepers, according to the UN, are that moment, that opening point for early stage peace building. And in 2015, is, you know, another example was a high level report on peace operations. And this is actually a much better quote. It says each mission should have or be able to draw upon requisite local, cultural, linguistic and country expertise to ensure regular and structured engagement with local communities, including women, youth, religious and other leaders, identify resources for commissioning of independent surveys of local perceptions of the mission and progress towards mission objectives linked to strategic communication efforts. So the idea is that peacekeeping missions, at least at a policy level, should always be speaking to those people who are most affected by conflict and most affected by violence, and be able to be responsive to that. And I think that's quite important when seeing, you know, what the function of peacekeeping missions are. Yes, it's partly to achieve stability and to stop violence, but there's this other level of interaction, of building up relationships. So I would say that the UN has got a policy there. However, what happens if this isn't fully understood? And I'll give a few examples here. The first is an example of well-intentioned activities that go wrong. And then the second example is when things aren't necessarily well-intentioned and do go wrong. So this is the first kind of thing about, you know, good intentions going wrong. This is from a Irish military kind of post-operational report. Now, this is the idea in this case in Liberia. The Irish battalion built an orphanage. That's what the story starts with. They wanted to build an orphanage. So the infantry battalion purchased land, built a house, furnished it, and opened it as an orphanage with monies raised from exclusively within the unit. Good feel-good factor here, significant. Up to some point, there were hearts and minds won for the mission. So it all sounds good at this point. The project was neither coordinated with the UNHCR as the lead agency, nor calculated as a force multiplier. It was a standalone humanitarian gesture driven by a perceived need and undertaken because the unit possessed sufficient capability and generosity. So you see what's happened here. Group of soldiers deployed, seen orphans as a result of the conflict, and they thought, we will build an orphanage. Didn't tell anyone really about what they were doing. They thought, this is exactly what we want to do. This will be the Irish orphanage. So if we move to the next slide, this is where it kind of goes wrong. At the end of the mission, at the end of their deployment, the battalion was criticized severely by UNHCR for undertaking the project without consultation or approval. The lead agency argued that there was far greater need in several other places and that a situation of dependency had now been created at the orphanage, which UNHCR could not service in the longer term. So this effectively was, you know, an unsustainable project that relied purely on the battalion that was deployed. It was further argued that if the monies raised by the infantry battalion had to be ring-fenced for work at the orphanage, then it would have been infinitely preferable to use the money in order to facilitate local people to take ownership of their own project and then do the work themselves. Again, another lesson from this with regards to the kind of good intention of a battalion. It totally bypassed local capacity. Totally just said, we will build this for you because militaries build stuff. That's what militaries are. They are doing actors. They can build a house in most probably an afternoon, but that doesn't do anything really for local capacities or the people in a conflict zone. So this is actually used as a training example in the Irish military, as to say, you know, we built this amazing orphanage. However, it ended up just being a building that people just, you know, couldn't do anything in. The second area, you know, these are challenges. These are significant challenges, and ones where I would argue that you can't put the good intentions bracket on. So I've got three here. First of all, these I would class as, you know, the things that the UN or UN missions do that absolutely will do the opposite to building effective peace building strategies and conflict de-escalation strategies. And there are three pictures. I mean, just going from the largest one, you have the outbreak of cholera in Haiti, where the UN peacekeepers from Nepal brought a strain of cholera into the country. And due to very poor latrine facilities, raw sewage was leaving the base into local water resources. Cholera spread rampantly through the country or through the area, leading to thousands of deaths. The UN's response was to deny it was a UN issue. It wasn't the UN that brought it. And it led to huge civil disobedience, very logically, against the UN mission there, because the UN's kind of denial of culpability, when in fact it was poor sanitation from a UN mission that led to this happening. In the top right, I've got a picture of a helicopter over the sea. It's a very good example of a mission that escalated the use of force in Somalia in 1992. There's more recent examples, but this was captured in popular culture with the film Black Hawk Down, where US service personnel were ultimately killed by, after a very fierce firefight with local militia groups in Somalia. This is all part of a UN mission linked, supported by the United States at the time. And the United States' approach in the Somalia operation was to eliminate key rebel leaders. And in fact, what it led to was the UN and the US mission being drawn into quite a deep and violent conflict themselves. And the bottom right is a cartoon in French, related basically to sexual exploitation and abuse in UN peacekeeper missions. I think it's when looking at how peacekeepers relate to local the locals and the peace building, you can't shy away from the fact that in too many cases, UN peacekeepers have been accused and found accountable, and in many cases not accountable, in the sense that the UN has failed to prosecute for issues of sexual exploitation and abuse of locals. And I think that's part of this whole picture, where the UN and UN missions have, at a very local level, have fundamentally rocked the UN's overall capacity and potential for resolving conflict. If UN personnel are exploiting both sexually and non-sexually local capacities, then the work for peacekeeping becomes a lot harder. So we'll just go to the final bit, the implication on training programs. So there's a whole wealth of activity on how peacekeepers are trained with all of this in mind. And how I see it is that training is currently on two levels, and we can talk about this further in the Q&A. On the first level, the research I've undertaken looks at the prescriptive approaches to training. So prescriptive approaches is much like what's happening now. I'm a specialist, give or take. I present you with my knowledge. You take the knowledge and you use it as you see fit, Militaries are very good at this type of knowledge. You go to a military training on a peacekeeping, there'll be a lot of PowerPoint at the beginning, a lot of information flow from expert to training. And this is good in some places, to understand what peacekeeping is, to understand the rules, to understand the mission area, let's say, the doctrine, mapping the territory of where you're going to be deploying to. So, what other organisations are there? But what that doesn't do, if you see how conflict, and the three of you, and four of you, including Ezekiel, and five, including Miho, have all kind of engaged in conflict resolution training or involved in this idea, there's a lot more to understanding conflict and understanding human reaction than just what you see on the PowerPoint. So what I've been looking at really in military training is the second aspect, which is linked to a chap called John Paul Lederach, who's written a lot in the peacebuilding field. And he kind of spoke about elicitive approaches to understanding conflict. So Lederach's work is largely in the civilian field, not in the military field, but speaks about how practitioners, instead of this kind of thing, where me speaking to you, a conflict resolution training program would be all of us sitting in a circle and you telling me about your experiences of conflict, how you dealt with it, what your knowledge of conflict is. And me being the specialist might facilitate that dialogue by adding my academic knowledge. But it would certainly not be me telling you what's right and what's wrong. In military training, you start to see this. Well, you do see this happen to some degree with peacekeeping training. You see, you know, role plays and scenarios really taking quite a big step forward. Work I did with the Irish military had them deploying for a week in a fake conflict zone in the middle of the Wicklow Mountains, in the middle of Ireland, with people role playing different agencies. And a lot of that process was quite interesting. So you'd have like somebody, you know, a soldier or a group of soldiers who would have a meeting with the UNHCR about something. They sit down and have a meeting. The UNHCR role players will give them a telling off about doing something wrong, or they create a coordinated plan. And then those soldiers would leave that meeting. And what was really important on this, I found in my research, was the debriefing. So you'd have an experienced soldier with this little group of learners, and they'd sit down afterwards and they'd say, okay, take your hats off. And they'd take their hats off. So they come out of role, effectively. And then they'd start speaking about how the meeting went. What did you do there? How did you speak? And it was about that. And that was why I found it very interesting, because it spoke about, you know, what are the communication skills that you need to make these meetings work? It's not about what policy did you enact. It's not about, you know, what will you do with this knowledge? Take it to your superior commander, bring it into this thing. They spoke about that with their hats on, kind of. But when the hats came off, it's a lot more about that relationship building aspect. And I think that is quite important when deploying military personnel for UN operations. I think these are kind of, I wouldn't say this is, you know, I don't have the confidence to say this is widespread over the 70,000 peacekeepers that are deployed. But, and I also don't also say this with the understanding that this isn't like providing a MA level understanding of peace and conflict studies to these practitioners. It is green shoots, but these green shoots are there. So to kind of move on to the final slide, really, there's skepticism about this link. And I think you see skepticism in two areas. First of all, from the academics, from the conflict resolution practitioners. There's a wonderful quote that was written in the mid-90s that I don't think has ever really been bettered on this. And this is from somebody who looked at training for peacekeeping in the 90s, somebody called Bets Featherston. And she said, there's no switch inside a blue helmet that automatically turns a soldier trained for war fighting into an individual prepared to work non-violently and with cultural sensitivity in a highly militarized environment. So that danger is always there. There's a very good article that was written not so long ago for a journal about UK soldiers in Afghanistan. And Afghanistan was classed as quite, when the UK first engaged in Afghanistan, it was seen as being a peace building guys, stabilization. You know, soldiers would be lightly armed and engaging with the population. In the end, the UK military was sending the parachute regiment into Helmand province. Some of the most hard equipped fighting units in the UK military. And they were sending these soldiers in to undertake political tasks of peace building. These soldiers wanted to fight. They identified people that wanted to fight them, of which there were people in Afghanistan that wanted to do it back. And the political aspects of this mission just went by the wayside. And there are examples of soldiers that will be on the frontiers of, you know, India and Pakistan. If we go back to that very early example, there could be soldiers that have been drawn off the frontier between India and Pakistan and then dropped into a peacekeeping mission in South Sudan. So that cognitive switch is always there. And secondly, you do get pushback from the military. Militaries don't really want soldiers to be doing peacekeeping too much because it takes away their fighting edge. And I think that's also where you see pushback. If the UN peacekeeping is large, but it may be to many militaries a secondary activity. And if soldiers are too invested in building local capacities, speaking about peace building, how does that play out for those higher up in military organizations that see militaries as war fighting machines, which is ultimately in many people's eyes their primary aim and function? So you see that pushback coming from different levels. So what I'll do, I'll leave it there. I've put a few references, that's the word I'm looking for, good journal on this, International Peacekeeping. And there's a few books out there. And if you want, I've put my email address at the on the first slide. So, you know, feel absolutely free to, you know, reach out and I can send you any more details. And yeah, thank you very much. We've got about 20 minutes, 15, 20 minutes for any questions.